Good afternoon, all of you. I invite all of you to my lecture on the carbohydrate metabolism. In continuation of my earlier lecture on carbohydrate metabolism, in this session, we will discuss in detail about glycolysis, energetics, its regulation, and its significance. So let's go ahead. So in the last class, what we have seen is the way how when carbohydrates are consumed, how digestion process happens and how glucose is obtained from that, and then how glucose enters into our body, and once it enters into your blood, how it is reaching different kinds of tissues like skeletal muscle or hepatic tissue or remaining tissues, and then how it reaches the cytosol, how it is transported across the membrane with the glucose transporter, and then it reaches the cytosol. So after reaching cell, what happens is what we have to see now. Fate of glucose in our body. Okay, so glucose, when once it enters into our body, the first thing is, because when the person does not need energy, then glucose will straight away go into, will be converted to glycogen, a form where, a storage form in our body, because glucose will be converted into glycogen and is stored in hepatic cells, in liver. So when energy is needed, glucose will be submitted to a process, we call it as glycolysis, which we will be seeing today. This process will give us pyruvic acid as the product, and a little bit of energy is also obtained. Now the pyruvic acid will have multiple roles to play. So pyruvic acids, let's say again, when energy is needed, pyruvic acid will be converted to acetyl coenzyme A. From acetyl coenzyme A, because that is the input for tricarboxylic acid cycle or citric acid cycle or Krebs cycle. So all these three terms you can use for TCA cycle. And then that TCA cycle will burn acetyl coenzyme A completely into carbon dioxide and water. And in this process, it will produce high energy compounds like GTP, FADH2 and NADH. And in the and when oxygen is there, all these high energy compounds will be submitted, like NADH and FADH2 are submitted to electron transport chain, and from there we actually get the ATPs. When energy is not needed, okay, then acetyl coenzyme that are produced will be converted to, will be utilized for biosynthesis of fatty acids. Fatty acids are another way of energy storage. Okay, so how many storages are there here? We have one. Glycogen is one storage mechanism and fatty acids is another storage mechanism for us. And then pyruvic acid, in the absence of oxygen, anaerobic metabolism, there pyruvic acid will be converted to lactic acid. We will see that one in Cori's cycle. Pyruvic acid is the input for ethanol production in microbial anaerobic fermentation reaction. Pyruvic acid is converted to ethanol. Now let's see a little bit about the history of glycolysis. So it all started with the great scientist Louis Pasteur, who has contributed a lot to microbiology, biotechnology and biochemistry, organic chemistry. So here, what is his contribution to glycolysis? Actually, he has proven for the first time, fermentation occurs by action of living microorganisms. Okay, so because when a biochemical reaction has to happen, a living being is involved, is needed over there. So that is the principles which we can summarize everything into one word, that is vitality. Okay, so here he proposed, like, cells can degrade chemicals by using certain biochemical reactions. And later on, Edward Buchner went ahead with non-cell, okay, non-cellular, okay, not whole cells, but he has obtained certain chemicals upon degradation of yeast cells, etc. And then that one, with that, he is able to perform certain biochemical reactions. So this is what we call it as cell-free fermentation reactions. So he actually proved the existence of enzymes which actually does the job. For this discovery, he was awarded Nobel Prize in 1907. and Sir Arthur Harden and Professor Hans actually investigated the enzymes involved in carbohydrate metabolism. So here, in continuation of whatever Professor Buchner has done, so here these scientists have done investigations on the fermentation of sugar, means glucose, and what are the different types of enzymes involved in the fermentation. And here they proved beyond doubt presence of 1,6 biphosphofructose in the fermentation process. The second one is the role of phosphoric acid, otherwise phosphates, in the enzyme action. Okay. And later on, Professor Archbald and then Professor Meyerhoff, these two have contributed to the functional biochemistry. Okay, because the way how your muscle is maintaining heat and how energy derived from carbohydrate metabolism is being used over there. This is one part. And then the second part is the discovery of fixed relationship between consumption of oxygen and the metabolism of lactic acid in the muscle. So these are the two things. Which are the outcomes of a glycolysis study. So for this discovery, they were awarded Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine in 1922. And Gustav Emden, because so far, whatever research work that has already happened, there fragmented information is there. Because in the beginning, till 1910, we know up to fructose 1,6 biphosphate, and later on aldolase was proposed, and then the role of glyceraldehyde was also studied by Professor Meyerhoff, and many other scientists have done fragmented works. What is the contribution of Gustav Emden? So he has pieced them together, stitched them together to provide us a detailed step-by-step procedure for glycolysis. Let's go to the glycolysis. So what is meant by glycolysis? Glycolysis derived from Greek words like glykis and lysis. Glykis means sweet and lysis means splitting. Means splitting of sugar. So what actually is happening and a little bit of outline we will see here. It happens in the cytosol. Because it does not need any kind of oxidative degradations. And so mitochondria is not needed over here. Because all the enzymes that are needed for glycolysis are available in the cytosol. So during this process, 1 mole of glucose, 6 carbon unit is degraded into 2 molecules of pyruvic acid, means 3 carbon molecule, and free energy released in this process is stored as 2 moles of ATP and 2 moles of NADH. So if you see the total energy that can be extracted from glucose upon burning is delta Z value is minus 2840 kilojoules per mole. Whereas in glycolysis, you will see at the end, the energy, total energy that can be obtained is glucose upon breakdown into pyruvic acid, you will get minus 146 kilojoules per mole. That is approximately 5.2% of total energy that can be released by glucose is released in glycolysis. That is significant energy. That energy is enough for running some of the important tissues in your body. That means some of the tissues in your body are in our body are surviving on glycolysis, largely on glycolysis, like a brain. So let's see the glycolysis, various steps that are involved in over here. Glycolysis contains 10 different biochemical steps. So in the first step, glucose is converted to glucose 6 phosphate. The enzyme that is involved over here is hexokinase or glucokinase. So here the coenzyme is ATP. So the phosphate unit, high energy phosphate that we have on ATP is transferred onto glucose. And magnesium is very much needed over here to facilitate this biochemical reaction. We will see in detail about each one of the steps separately. And the glucose 1,6 phosphate will be converted to fructose 6 phosphate with the help of phosphohexose isomerized. Then fructose 6 phosphate will be converted to fructose 1,6 biphosphate with the help of phosphofructokinase, with the help of here one more ATP is consumed. And then aldolase is the enzyme which gives us which will break down fructose into two carbon units, glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate as well as dihydroxyacetone phosphate. glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate are interconvertible with the help of triose isomerase is the enzyme. Okay, but between these two, glyceraldehyde is the key chemical from where the remaining glycolysis cycle will go. So glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate is converted to 1,3 biphosphoglycerate with the help of glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme. So here two things happen. One is phosphorylation of glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate to obtain 1,3 biphosphoglycerate, and then oxidation. Okay, so where the protons that are abstracted from the aldehyde group is taken up by NAD plus to obtain NADH. So this 1,3 biphosphoglycerate is a very high energy molecule, so that will degrade in the presence of 3 phosphoglycerate kinase, and then the phosphate, high energy phosphate, is transferred from 1,3 biphosphoglycerate to ADP to obtain ATP. So this is the first ATP obtained from substrate level phosphorylation. So 3 phosphoglycerate in the presence of phosphoglyceromutase is the enzyme which converts 3 phosphoglycerate to 2 phosphoglycerate, means phosphoric acid unit, phosphoric acid ester unit is shifted from third carbon to second carbon. So from here, 2 phosphoglycerate is dehydrated in the presence of enolase to give us 2 phosphoenoyl pyruvate. So this 2 phosphoenoyl pyruvate in the presence of pyruvate kinase give us pyruvate, and the high energy phosphate group we have over there is transferred to ADP to obtain ATP. So this is the second ATP obtained via substrate level phosphorylation. So in the absence of oxygen, pyruvate is converted to lactate, means lactate dehydrogenase is the enzyme which will reduce pyruvate to lactate. So friends, this is actually the outline of glycolysis. Now let's see one by one what exactly is the chemistry that is happening. So in the first, you can see, because glucose exists as a pyranose form, so in the presence of pyranose, because all the hydroxy groups are very close to ring, whereas the hydroxy group over here is protruding outside, it is like this. We have a big ring, and then this is more like a hand. Okay, so that enzyme can access this area, and then from ATP phosphate can be attached to this hand. Okay, so in this way, a hexokinase can convert glucose to glucose 6 phosphate. It is 99.99999%, it is irreversible, and then the delta G value over here is so significant high. So that's the reason why it happens instantaneously. Now the glucose 6 phosphate, glucose to glucose 6 phosphate needs magnesium. So the job of magnesium is this one. Because in case of ATP, if you see, the 3 phosphate units we have are connected via sp3 bonds. Oxygen, phosphor, oxygen, phosphor, oxygen, phosphor. All these are sp3 bonds, where because of the single bonded nature, the phosphate groups, they keep on they are highly flexible, so many conformations are possible. So that's the reason why, to stabilize this magnesium that is there in the enzyme as a cofactor, that stabilizes ATP, so that phosphate will be easily transferred onto the hydroxy group over here. So that is the reason why we need magnesium, which will stabilize oxygens like this, so thereby it reduces mobility of this phosphate unit. The next one is isomerase. So because, as I told you, for phosphorylation we needed a handle. Okay, in case of glucose, we have a cyclohexane unit, or otherwise 6-membered unit like this, and then one handle is there. We don't have any other handle on the other side, so that's why it is converted to fructose, so thereby it facilitates attachment of the second phosphate unit. Okay, so you have the second handle over here in this way, and this isomerization does not need much energy, because the heat energy that we have inside our body, that itself is enough for this entire process. So let's see actually what happens in case of this conversion. See here, you can clearly see inside the enzyme pocket, because as you all knew, this is an acetal bond. Okay, OH group adds across the C double bond O and gives you this type of bond, and the reaction is OH attacks the C double bond O, means aldehyde group in the sugar unit. This O attacks this carbon, so thereby it gives you this type of bond, and this reaction is reversible. So that's why it will open up like this, and double bond O is generated. So this double bond O, because you have on the alpha carbon you have one proton, so this type, in this type of situation you can have ketoenol type of tautomerism possible. Okay, here we have enolized enol, proton is there, O minus is there, and here we have the OH. So when you have enol like this, double bond on one side OH, and on the other side also another OH, then it will give you two opportunities. One is you can have carbonyl generated on the other, this side or this side, means you can have C double bond O CH2OH, means like a ketose, or CHOH and CHO. Okay, the two possibilities will be there. Two possibilities will be there. So that's the reason why. So here what happens is it will go to the other side. Okay, so this one will become double bond O, and then now the OH group will come over here and attack this double bond O. Literally here what is happening is glucose is getting converted to fructose. So with fructose you will have, instead of pyranose in case of glucose, you will have a furanose structure in case of fructose. So that's how the conversion happens. In the next reaction, the glucose 1 phosphate, because we have the extra handle over here, that will be converted to one fructose 1,6 biphosphate. Now the fructose 1,6 biphosphate will be degraded to glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate and dihydroxy acetone phosphate, because this is acetone, we have hydroxy, one of the hydroxy is phosphorylated over here, and this and these two chemicals are interrelated, because with the same logic whatever we have shown in the earlier, this double bond O will go to enol state, enolized. So once it is enolized, either this carbon or this carbon, either one of these two can become double bond O. So if it becomes double bond O, you will get aldehyde group, or else if you if this becomes a double bond O, you will get a ketone group. That's why dihydroxyacetone phosphate as well as glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, both are interconvertible, and there is no energy needed right now here in this process. It happens at your body temperature, no problem, that heat is sufficient. And then the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, okay, so this is the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, where on the terminal hydroxy group we have the phosphoric acid ester. This is the phosphoric acid ester. On the other hand, other side you have the aldehyde group. So here two things happens. One is oxidation of aldehyde to carboxylic acid. Second one is phosphorylation. So here what actually drives this reaction? So here two things are there. One is, you know the chemistry of aldehyde, okay? Aldehydes are highly amenable for oxidation. Aldehydes are highly amenable for oxidation. Maybe you might have observed this one in your organic chemistry laboratory, where if you take benzaldehyde, okay, and if you keep it aside for some time, you take a little bit of benzaldehyde, and if you keep it aside for some time, benzaldehyde is a liquid in nature, okay, benzaldehyde can be easily oxidized to benzoic acid at room temperature. So in almost all the cases, when benzaldehyde bottles, if you see, if it is not closed properly, or if a little bit of benzaldehyde is remaining at the edges of the bottle, that liquid will be converted to solid within a couple of days. You don't need to add any chemical, you don't need to do any reactions, okay? It can be oxidized because aldehyde group is highly reactive and it tends to get oxidized in appropriate conditions or when appropriate conditions are created. It does not need much energy because this double bond O is highly polarized. So this entropy built that is there inside, okay? So that internal energy actually drives the reaction forward. So this will be facilitated by using a coenzyme like NAD plus, which has the capability to abstract a proton. So in this way, aldehyde is converted to carboxylic acid. In this process, because of the energy that is available over here, inorganic phosphate can be esterified onto this group. Now, so far what we have seen is we are spending a lot of energy. In the beginning we have spent 2 moles of ATP and then we have sacrificed the energy that is there in the aldehyde group. We have packed energy into smaller units. Now we have to harvest energy. Now let's see how the energy is harvested, because this 1,3 biphosphoglycerate that we have in the presence of phosphoglycerokinase. Okay, here also we need magnesium ion. So this will transfer this high energy phosphate group. In the last class, high energy compounds, okay, we have seen this compound. This is one of the highly enriched, energy enriched compounds where you find 61 kilojoules of energy per mole. Okay, so that's why it can easily transfer this phosphate group onto ADP. So thereby you can get 3 phosphoglycerate and then ATP. So this is the example of substrate level phosphorylation. It does not require any kind of oxygen from outside. In an anaerobic environment, it can be done. The next one is 3 phosphoglycerate is isomerized to 2 phosphoglycerate with the help of phosphoglyceromutase. So why this happened? That we see in the next line. So this 2 phosphoglycerate is dehydrated to obtain phosphoenol pyruvate. Let's say you compare these two functional group. Okay, both are phosphoric acid esters only. So here, what is this group? This is actually OH group of an alcohol and phosphoric acid. Okay, and is this a high energy group? High energy bond. In case of ATP, we have adenosine and phosphate and phosphate. 3 phosphates will be there. So this is a high energy bond where we can get approximately 31 kilojoules of energy. Here also we have a high energy bond where we can get approximately 31 kilojoules of energy. But here this is an ester bond, phosphoric acid ester bond, simple ester bond. And this is not a high energy bond. So this is also like that. This is not a high energy bond. But if you see this one, this comes under the category esters of phosphoric acid and enol. Enols are acidic in nature slightly, and phosphoric acid is also an acid. So acidic and acidic. So that's why this group is a high energy bond, but this is not a high energy bond. To facilitate conversion of this compound to this compound, actually the isomerization happened. Okay, so here this is a high energy bond. Now this phosphoenol pyruvate, in the next step the phosphoenol pyruvate will give its phosphate, high energy phosphate, to another ADP, so that one more substrate level phosphorylation happens and an ATP is generated. So for every single unit of pyruvic acid, 2 ATPs are produced. What does it mean? From glucose to pyruvic acid, to obtain pyruvic acid, 2 units of pyruvic acid, we are spending 2 ATPs. But from pyruvic acid to, from glyceraldehyde, sorry, cut. So we are spending 2 ATPs to convert glucose to glyceraldehyde monophosphate. From there, to obtain pyruvic acid, for every glyceraldehyde monophosphate, we are generating 2 ATPs to obtain a pyruvic acid. That means we are going to generate 4 ATPs and 2 NADH per glyceraldehyde, per glucosinate. So if you see the net conversions, you will be getting 2 ATPs and 2 NADH molecules. So at the end, let's say when there is no oxygen available, then what will happen? So as we have seen, the pyruvic acid will be reduced to lactate. So this is pyruvic acid where double bond O is there, that is converted to lactic acid where we have hydroxy group. NADH is converted to NAD+. Because in case of oxidation reduction reactions, oxidizing equivalents and reducing equivalents are in one or the other way the coenzymes only. Because the NAD plus concentration and NADH concentration, FADH2 concentration and FAD plus concentration. So these are the level, these are the entities which maintain oxidation, which contribute significantly to the oxidation reduction potential of the cell. So in the absence of oxygen, to compensate the fluctuations in oxidation reduction kind of environments, NADH is sacrificed to convert pyruvic acid to lactic acid. Lactic acid can be eliminated from your system or it can be submitted to liver for Corey's cycle. Okay. So in this way, anaerobic environment glycolysis ends in producing lactic acid. So friends, I hope you have understood so far. So to summarize everything, glyceraldehyde monophosphate, by taking up glyceraldehyde phosphate, okay, takes up NAD+, and then it will be converted to 1,3-biphosphoglycerate, and 1,3-biphosphoglycerate will be becoming 3-phosphoglycerate to 2-phosphoglycerate, then to phosphoenolpyruvate, and then pyruvic acid. So in this process, from glyceraldehyde monophosphate to pyruvic acid, we are producing 2 ATPs and 1 NADH. So in the expenditure stage, from glucose to glyceraldehyde phosphate, we had already spent 2 ATPs. So that's why net 2 ATPs are going to be staying back. Okay, so here we have a net production of 2 ATPs per glucose, and then 2 NADH also are generated, and then it is an acidic environment, so 4 protons are also generated. In total, glycolysis provides ATPs. ATP means energy. So in your body, ATP that are produced from glycolysis are the major energy resource for certain tissues, like your brain. Your brain largely depends on glucose. More than 60% of carbohydrate that you are consuming in the form of glucose, your brain is going to be making use of that entire glucose. Okay, so major consumer of glucose in your body is brain, where glycolysis provides large share of energy that is needed for your brain. And in the disease condition, I'll give you one example where the best example is cancer. Okay, in case of cancers, how can you define a cancer? In case of cancer, uncontrolled growth of non-functional tissue happens in case of cancer. Means the cells are dividing at a uncontrollable pace. Okay, so when the division, cell division is happening, when tissue growth is there, proportionally blood supply also is supposed to increase. So for that, atherogenesis is needed. Means blood cells are to be supplied. Blood is to be supplied to each one of the dividing newly formed cell. For that, blood vessels are supposed to form at the same rate as cancer cell, which will not happen. So that's the reason why large proportion of cancer tissue remains in anaerobic environment, because blood supply is not completely available to the cancer tissue. So that's the reason why within cancer tissue, anaerobic environment exists. So thereby, anaerobic environment in case of in anaerobic environment, a tissue can survive. A tissue can provide and obtain energy only via glycolysis. So that's the reason why scientists have proved beyond doubt that glucose is the main source of energy for cancer cell. Okay, this is another very important observation we have to note down. The second chemical which is provided by glycolysis is NADH. NADH does two things. One is it helps in maintenance of oxidation reduction potential. Second one is in the presence of oxygen, one NADH will be submitted for electron transport chain, where the energy that is built in NADH is leveraged, is utilized for production of 3 ATPs. In some of the books, it is written as 1 NADH is equal to 2.5 ATP, but it's fine. Okay, in that way, by using electron transport chain, NADH can produce ATPs. The third one is pyruvic acid, because for every glycolysis, one glucose through glycolysis, two pyruvic acids are obtained. Pyruvic acids have multiple roles to play, because we have seen in the initial slides the kind of roles the pyruvic acid will play. Pyruvic acid, in fact, it also does one more thing. That is, pyruvic acid is the input for biosynthesis of certain amino acids, like, because double bond O is there here, you can have amine COOH, CH3, and here if you have NH2, so what is this compound? CH3CHNH2COOH. So this is alanine. Okay, alanine is biosynthesized from pyruvic acid. So there also a pyruvic acid plays a major role, but in anaerobic condition it is degraded to lactic acid. Otherwise pyruvic acid is converted to acetyl coenzyme A, and acetyl coenzyme A will enter into citric acid cycle, or else acetyl coenzyme A will go to fatty acid biosynthesis. So either of these things are possible. Pyruvate is a very important biochemical for both energy as well as both anabolic as well as catabolic reactions. At the end, okay, because let's see a little bit about the Corey cycle, a very important cycle which links up the role of liver as well as skeletal muscle in the energy expenditure cycle, especially related to carbohydrate metabolism. The two scientists, Getty Corey and Carl Corey, so these two have discovered the course of catalytic conversion of glycogen, and in the study of carbohydrate metabolism, they found a very important relation between hepatic metabolism and skeletal muscle metabolism. For their contributions, they were awarded with the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine in 1947. In brief, this is Corey's cycle, where in skeletal muscle, let's say in case of oxygen, let's say oxygen is there, glucose is converted to pyruvic acid, because through glycolysis glucose is converted to pyruvic acid, and then once it is converted to pyruvic acid, the pyruvic acid will enter into blood, and then through blood it will reach liver, where pyruvic acid is taken up, and then liver will initiate a pathway, we call it as gluconeogenesis. So from pyruvate, glucose is biosynthesized. The glucose will be, there is a possibility that glucose can enter into glycogen. Okay, so this is the way. Or else glucose will again enter into blood glucose, depending upon the work schedule or otherwise the energy demands of the skeletal muscle. So when in the absence of oxygen, pyruvate will be converted to lactate. It is a reduction reaction. Lactate will enter into blood as blood lactate, and then it will enter into liver, where lactic acid will be converted to pyruvic acid, and the remaining process will start and the cycle will be initiated again. So in this way, carbohydrate metabolism that is happening in liver and carbohydrate metabolism that is happening in skeletal muscle are linked. Okay, this is what we call it as Corey's cycle. And now, so far what we have seen, we know what exactly is glycolysis, how actually it happens, and what are all the various steps that we have, and how much energy that we can get, and what are the various enzymes, coenzymes and cofactors that are involved in the entire glycolytic pathway, and the relation between different tissues that are involved in carbohydrate metabolism in the form of Cori cycle. That is what we have seen so far. So in this, let's see how actually glycolysis is regulated. Because glycolysis is an energy producing pathway, okay? Because it has to be controlled. It has to happen according to energy requirements of the body. So that's the reason why some of the enzymes that we have in glycolysis are supposed to be controlled. So here you can see these are the four enzymes: hexokinase, phosphofructokinase, pyruvate kinase. These are the three enzymes that we have in actual glycolytic cycle. And when oxygen is not there in anaerobic environment, lactic dehydrogenase enzyme is there. So all these can be regulated in glycolysis. In general, let's say as we had just now seen, in what type of conditions glycolysis will be initiated? Okay, it's a very simple logic. So when there is a need for energy, like when ATP, so much of ATP is there in your body, then are you supercharged or otherwise discharged? So we are supercharged. So that's why at that time we don't need any energy. We are simply eating and sleeping. So at that type of in that type of situation, we don't need any glycolysis to be accelerated. Whereas if somebody is on fasting cycle, and when energy demand is there, energy demand reflects in the concentration of ADP and inorganic phosphate. So in this condition, all these enzymes will be accelerated. Okay. And then what are the inhibitors? Obviously ATP will be the inhibitor. Okay. And then what are all the equivalents of ATP? Creatine phosphate and ATP, they both are considered as high energy resources, which are utilizable by skeletal muscles. So that's why these two. And then citrate. When more and more of citric acid is there in Krebs cycle, the first step is citric acid will be synthesized. So if you slow down citric acid cycle, that citric acid will be shunted outside. So with the increase in citric acid, it indicates that Krebs cycle got slowed down. So indirectly it is saying that your energy demands are reduced. So that's how glycolysis is to be retuned, readjusted, so that it will also be slowed down. So in this way, all these are interconnected. Okay. So what are all the stimulators? ADP, inorganic phosphate, increase in pH, and ammonium ion concentration. What are the inhibitors? ATP, creatine phosphate, citrate, glucose 6 phosphate. Okay. Because hexokinase is controlled with the concentration of glucose 6 phosphate. This is what we call it as allosteric inhibition. Okay. So this is the way how all these enzymes are controlled. And this chart, energy chart, I am showing you just to let you know that here and here, okay, first one is hexokinase and then phosphofructokinase. In these two cases, you can see the delta G values are significantly low. Okay. So, these are low in energy. That means the reactions will happen instantaneously, and then they are almost irreversible. Irreversible. And then in the other biochemical reactions where the delta G value is very less, like in all these, the reaction can happen in a reversible manner. They will happen in a reversible manner. So friends, this is the way how glycolysis plays a major role in our body. We'll stop our discussion here, and then we'll continue carbohydrate metabolism in the with the chapter Krebs cycle in the next class. I thank all of you for your patient listening. I request you to please give me your feedback, or if you have any doubts, or if you could not understand any of the concepts, please post them in the comment section. Please share this video with all your friends and subscribe to my channel to get latest updates. Thank you for your time. I'll meet you again with the next lecture. Thank you.